Creo que le había dado a lo que era. Ahora.
Okay,
Hey.
hola.
Hola. How are you? ¿Cómo estás?
Bien,
Bien.
gracias.
Bien,
I'm
bien. Good, good. So, we're going to talk a little bit in English. I'm going to practice my English,
good.
actually. To
Okay.
practice. So you can answer like freely, and I think it's better too for everyone listening. Like we have a lot of people from Latin America also that I guess I'm gonna translate later on, but for me it was very important to have you here. Thank you for your time.
No, of course. Thank you for having me. Gracias por tenerme. Yo tengo que practicar mi español también, so don't be afraid to go in and out.
It sounds good. It sounds good.
Gracias. Thank you.
So I have one question here, like the first one. This is like people that I know and people from Instagram that they made the questions. I have this one related to the coronavirus. What do you think of the situation in Puerto Rico where the federal government does not allow my country to close the airports? This week, several cases have come from New York City, people whose fever symptoms were not detected because they were taking Tylenol. Then they arrive on the island and infect more people using up what little medical equipment we have for the people here. So, yeah, that's the question. Like, what can we do as Puerto Ricans when we can't control that? And it's really affecting us right now because at first we didn't have like too many people infected, and because of that, and we're still open and people still coming and tourists still coming and I can see them, and it's so is there something that we can do?
Yeah, no, it one of the things that we are seeing with coronavirus is that it is amplifying all the injustices that we already had. And for example, with our brothers and sisters in the Black community, it's amplified the health disparities for nuestras hermanos y hermanas inmigrantes. It's made all of these disparities even worse. And when it comes to Puerto Rico, it has only amplified the injustices of the colonial status of the island. Because if Puerto Rico was did not have this kind of second class kind of relationship with the larger United States, we would be able to have more control over our island's policies, either directly or indirectly through control of our own finances, which we know La Junta takes much of that power away. And so other states, they've been able to kind of suspend or create different policies around non-essential travel, but it also amplified this relationship as well, even just the mentality as well, when the government started issuing these lockdown orders. All of these flights started getting much cheaper because nobody was flying anymore. But the few people who saw that started to say, oh, it's vacation time. I'm going to take a $50 ticket to Puerto Rico. Coming from a place that is heavily infected or coming from a place that's heavily at risk. And people decided that they were going to go on vacation without thinking about the disease that they were bringing into the island. It's so reflective of the colonial relationship that that Puerto Rico has long had with the United States. And it's almost cruel irony because one of the initial symptoms of colonization was the infection of indigenous peoples, almost. It's almost like an echo into history. And so one of the things that has shown us is that La Isla, Puerto Rico, it amplifies the need for us to have more control, proper control over our island, and the need, and it shows us how self-determination is a matter of life and death for us.
Do you think that we should, and this is me thinking, because like, should we lock down ourselves, like the airport? Like, don't give a damn of what the government, the federal government is saying. I know that maybe it's uncomfortable for you to say, but I'm like, if I if I'm a governor of the island and I can see people drowning, like that, like dying, I'm not gonna wait for someone to tell me to help them out. I'm just gonna go and help them out. Like, I think, I don't know, we should lock down the airport, because mm-hmm. we don't want any more flights, because we depend on Trump and everyone else to decide, and they're taking, like, they're already took, like, equipment for you know, I'm not against mm-hmm. human beings, like they have their needs, but it's the same mm-hmm. way Trump locked down I think he locked down the city from the flights from Europe or something in a certain point.
Ya, perdón, y también hay mucha persona que está pidiendo por español, so yo quiero tratar a traducir, you know, and go a little bit into Spanglish a little bit. Pero la pregunta es ¿por qué no podemos, como la isla de Puerto Rico, ¿por qué no podemos cerrar los aeropuertos? Sí. Y yo estoy de acuerdo, porque hay mucho viaje que son como no esenciales. Y yo creo que, bueno, si tiene que regresar a visitar familia, si tiene que venir, si está haciendo trabajo esencial, yo creo que podemos abrir los aeropuertos, pero si personas están viajando en vacaciones o cualquier otra cosa, no deberíamos a traer personas aquí a Puerto Rico y la isla debe tener el poder de hacer eso si es necesario.
Sí, de poder cerrar. Es para que la gente entienda en Latinoamérica que uh-huh. lo que está pasando es que no podemos cerrar los aeropuertos porque no nos dan el permiso el gobierno federal y el gobierno de Trump. Por ende, siguen llegando turistas o siguen llegando gente de ciudades que o hacen escala para no llegar directamente de Nueva York, se toman Tylenol, se les baja la fiebre y luego acá les explota el coronavirus y usan uh-huh. el equipo que tenemos, que no tenemos mucho equipo, tenemos uh-huh. el equipo es limitado ya en Puerto Rico.
Sí, y todavía con el equipo, pero también el gobierno federal se trata Puerto Rico diferente. En los otros estados no hay como un tan como like a ceiling, like a cap, con los costas de Medicaid. Pero con Puerto Rico ellos dicen, mira, aquí hay cualquier millones a gastar con Medicaid, pero cuando se gasta, eso es todo, se gasta. Y sí. Cuando personas vienen aquí, y cuando se viene de vacaciones y se pone enfermo, y después ellos tienen que ir a la hospitales, personas que vienen de vacación, ellos están quitando de eso dinero de nosotros para isleños, para personas sí, para puertorriqueños, para boricuas. Y eso también, todos esos problemas se montan y montan y montan.
Sí, van creciendo aquí. Tengo algo relacionado, una pregunta relacionada a la anterior, like this one. It's kind of not the same, but like colonial policies affect health outcomes. For example, as a colony, Puerto Rico depends on the Medicaid funds. Both Puerto Rico is much lower than any other place mm-hmm. in the U.S., except for U.S. Virgin Islands, with reimbursement arbitrarily capped at 55% versus the rest of the U.S., which is 83%. Mm-hmm. Can you help me understand why? How is that justified?
This is again, I, you know, it goes back to these colonial policies. We treat the federal government and federal policies treats Puerto Rico and Puerto Ricans completely differently than they treat other states and any other American citizen. And so what that means is, so there's no real reasoning for it. There's no legitimate reason as to why we reimburse Medicaid in Puerto Rico differently than we reimburse Medicaid in the United States, in the continental United States, in the rest of the United States. And so really a lot of these policies, and I've seen it, I've confronted it firsthand when, you know, because we do have Puerto Ricans in Congress representing other states, Nidia Velázquez, myself, otros, you know, otras congresistas, sí. Pero we try to fight for the island, even given the fact that we're in New York and other places. And the response that we always get, especially from this administration, es que Trump tiene un odio a la isla que es personal. Es personal. If it, si tiene la palabra Puerto Rico, él no quiere pasarlo y él no quiere ayudar. Pero también es importante a reconocer que estos problemas fue anterior de Trump. Porque antes que Trump fue la Junta. Y eso fue una administración demócrata que apoyó la Junta. Que ahora están, you know, la estructura de la Junta es matando personas. No podemos traer recursos a los hospitales, a nuestras escuelas, a otras a cosas, you know, de infraestructura. So it's these are problems that are amplified by Trump. Trump is making them much worse, but they are problems that existed before Trump. And that's the thing that's important for us to recognize. And it's uncomfortable, but it was under a Democratic administration that the Promesa Act passed and La Junta was established. And so we need to recognize that, I believe at least, Trump is a symptom. He is not the core problem. He is one of the largest symptoms of the deeper problems of structural inequality.
Yeah, like I think that you're right, and that sends me to the next question. No sé si entendieron esta pregunta, la última que le hice, que es que al ser una colonia de Estados Unidos, pues los fondos médicos que llegan a la isla son tan bajos, son casi la mitad más bajo de lo que le llega al resto de los estados de Estados Unidos, uh-huh. Y excepto, dice, both places, except Virgin Islands. O sea que el 55% llega de ayuda versus un 83% que le llega a todos los demás en Estados Unidos. O sea que no estamos recibiendo tampoco la ayuda necesaria de parte del gobierno de Estados Unidos. Entonces, esta siguiente pregunta va con lo que estabas hablando. Regarding the presidential election in November, Biden is the nominee. You and I were Bernie supporters. The Democratic Party machine decided to line up behind Biden, whose neoliberal positions will be better than Trump. Anything is better than Trump. But will not create all the changes we need. Corporations, mm-hmm. and special interest groups will continue to dictate policy. So how does the party challenge the status quo with a more progressive agenda?
Mm-hmm. Bueno, eso es una pregunta excelente, y si me puede ayudar, si puede ayudarme a traducirlo, pero voy a tratar en inglés y en español. Yeah. I think one of the issues, you know, if we're going to be honest with ourselves, which we must be honest with ourselves, is that this is not a comfortable position to be in. You know, the fact that we that these are our two options for November, for a lot of people, these are not the options that we wanted. And I think sometimes there is this, there's this kind of bad culture, sometimes in Democrats, where when the primary is over, it becomes this like, you're either with us or against us, and you're not allowed to thoughtfully engage or critique the policies that are coming. And yes, if you dare critique the nominee in any way, it's like, well, you're on Trump's side. And I think we need to have so much more nuance than that, because if you suffocate that, it will only create resentment, and we should not do that. I think we have to push, especially, you know, como Latinos tenemos un papel muy importante ahora en esta elección, porque estamos, bueno, somos votantes y en estados que son muy importantes para demócratas, en Colorado, Arizona y más. Estados que puede, bueno, que podemos llevar en noviembre, pero así, pero tenemos que usar ese papel y ese poder a empujar por políticas que son para nosotros. Tenemos que empujar en temas como Puerto Rico, tenemos que empujar en temas de inmigración, en temas de, como de trabajos, de familias trabajadoras. Y podemos usar el poder que tenemos como votantes a empujar a Joe Biden, porque yo estaba con, yo estaba trabajando y yo estaba en una conversación con activistas en Puerto Rico, en la isla, uno o dos días más antes, y ellos me dijo, bueno, ¿qué son, qué es la esperanza que podemos hacer más por Puerto Rico aquí en este momento con en el paquete de emergencia que viene? ¿Qué, qué es la esperanza en que podemos quitar la junta o cancelar la deuda? Y yo les dije, mira, con Trump no tenemos mucha esperanza, pero tenemos que reconocer que Biden apoyó mucho de estas políticas también y tenemos que empujar a él. Pero yo creo que tenemos, bueno, con Biden tenemos más, bueno, we have more room with him.
Sí, más espacio.
Sí, tenemos más espacio con él que tenemos con Trump. Y si es, mira, yo, mi familia es en la isla, mi familia es en Puerto Rico, mi abuelas, mis primas, primos, tías, tíos, y este como, este es un choice que tenemos, sí. Y es un choice de vida o muerte, y ya, ya sabemos eso con María, y con Irma, y con los terremotos.
Sí, sí, sí. No, gracias, ahí, en verdad lo dijiste bastante bien en español.
Oh, gracias.
Sí, está bastante claro. Para los que no saben, en Latinoamérica, Alessandra es una congresista, y para mí es de vanguardia en su mentalidad, en su pensamiento, políticamente hablando, y es de las personas que se necesitan para que el mundo se mueva hacia adelante y no vaya en retroceso, no vaya hacia atrás. Acá tengo también, déjame ver, okay, tengo, bueno, tengo una que me mandó un amigo doctor y científico de la Universidad de Yale, y se lo mando en video porque creo que está bien. Déjame subirle el volumen y lo pongo así.
Question about testing. There's a shortage on testing both in Puerto Rico and in the U.S. And part of the reason why there's a shortage is not so much that there's a shortage on the specific reagents that are needed, is that these reagents have been built into kits that are made by specific pharmaceutical companies. And those companies have been unable to supply the kits for the machines that they usually run. And the reason is because the kits are custom made for those machines. And if you don't have the right kit for the right machine for that specific company, then you cannot run the tests. It reminds me of the Nestle coffee pots. If you don't have, you can have coffee in your house, but if you don't have the right coffee pot, you cannot run the Nestle coffee machine. So my question is, I have two questions. The first one is, what kind of regulations do we need to prevent this from happening in the future? Because unlike the Nestle coffee machines, these are tests that are needed to protect people's lives. And if these pharmaceutical companies are unable to supply them, because they have mm-hmm. essentially established systems, like the printers are a good example too, like the cartridges, you can only use those cartridges for those printers. So if these machines, you can only use these specific kits, then they're limiting the ability of the world to do this type of tests. And this is quite specific to the US because other places, like other countries, have been able to implement the test broadly. So what kind of regulations will Congress think of for the future in case there are pandemics like this, so that this doesn't occur again? That's number one. And the second thing for these particular companies, I'm thinking about companies like Roche, which in Puerto Rico, there are about 5 labs that could be running thousands of tests for people of Puerto Rico using the Roche equipment. But the Roche company is only supplying one test kit a day, one or two, to a single lab. limiting greatly the amount of tests that can be run in Puerto Rico. So is there any regulation in terms of how these kits that are being made by these companies are being distributed? Like, how does that add up with things like health disparities, for example? Are they sending less kits to places like Puerto Rico or the USVI or communities of colors that might then result in fewer tests and a higher incidence of both the virus and then death?
Mm-hmm. Oh, you got so yeah, that was the question from Daniel.
Sorry, someone was calling me.
Okay, it's okay.
This is such an important issue for us to talk about because it is part of the symptom of our for-profit healthcare system. We saw even inklings of this back when Trump was talking to Germany and he wanted to develop a vaccine. And so he was in talks with other countries, but basically when all of these things fell apart was when he said, okay, we'll get a vaccine, but only if we can have a monopoly on it. Only if we can have a monopoly so that we can own that vaccine so that it's not available to everybody, but so that we can kind of have exclusivity over it. So we could either charge a lot of money or we can pick and choose who receives it and who doesn't receive it. And if I'm not mistaken, Germany basically said no. And we had the ability to pursue a vaccine, or we had the ability to pursue treatment or novel testing. And it has repeatedly been rejected because it is not, it does not align with for-profit pharmaceutical interests. Yes. And so a lot of what's happening right now, you know, the Trump administration especially, they've been trying to create exclusivity deals and tax carve-outs for pharmaceutical corporations. And these types of testing equipment that the doctor was talking about, which is almost like he was saying, it's like when you have the coffee machines and you try to put a Keurig in a Nestle, but there's still the same coffee inside. It's literally just the models of the equipment. They make them so that they don't fit together so that people have to pay more. That is absolutely part of this system. And so in terms of what we can do, there are things that could be done. We could, if we wanted to, we could essentially take public ownership of certain critical essential vaccines or testing equipment, or at least make public versions of those equipment, of those types of equipments, where the reagents that he's talking about, you know, we shouldn't have name brand reagents. Like, it shouldn't be like Nike coronavirus testing kits versus Adidas versus et cetera, which is basically how these systems are being set up.
I think it should be illegal. I think it should be illegal, like when it's about health, you know what I mean? Like, if it's not a game, it's not an Apple system or Nintendo or whatever, it's we're talking about health. So it should be illegal to do that, to make a machine that is for making tests and you do it in a way that you create a monopoly out of it. And it, you know, it's, I don't think it's correct, but yeah.
Right, and it also raises the larger question, which is if certain life or death diseases should be, if treatment for certain life for coronavirus should be free because it's life and death, then why shouldn't treatment for diabetes or cancer or any other medical condition be free, at least at the point of service? And if anything, it only highlights our need for a single payer system like Medicare for All.
Perfect. Thank you. I think I have space for one more. I don't know if you know Manuel Natal. He's from Puerto Rico. So he sent a video and I thought it was interesting. So I'm going to play it and let me see.
Hola René, Manuel Natal por acá, gracias por la oportunidad y gracias a la congresista por contestar nuestras preguntas.
My question for Congresswoman Ocasio-Cortez is, what is the U.S. Congress doing to protect working people during this crisis? Particularly, what is the U.S. Congress doing to make sure that the money, the public funds that are being handed out to different industries and sectors, private sectors in the U.S. and in Puerto Rico, doesn't end up being used towards subsidizing layoffs in those mm-hmm. same sectors and industries. In Puerto Rico, for example, the government of Puerto Rico has applied or approved multiple initiatives to help out private hospitals in Puerto Rico. But at the same time, those hospitals are laying off hundreds and hundreds of employees, particularly nurses. At the same time, the Legislative Assembly in Puerto Rico is considering a bill that would allow private education institutions to reduce the salary of teachers in Puerto Rico, and we obviously cannot allow that. So my question is, what is the U.S. Congress doing to make sure that the money that we're giving in public funds doesn't end up subsidizing the thousands and thousands of employees being laid off? Thank you, mm-hmm. Renee. Thank you, Alexandria.
Yeah.
Thank you. So one of the problems, you know, there are some aspects of the bill that protect workers, but other aspects that don't. And the irony of this bill is that there were kind of two aspects. So one was this huge Wall Street bailout that was passed in this bill. And then there was another one that were these kind of forgivable loans for small businesses. And there was a package for small business. And in the legislation, there is more accountability and there are more rules and there are more provisions to protect workers in the small business part that is much smaller of this bill than there is in the Wall Street part of this bill. And so there's so much work that needs to be done. They passed the first part of the bill. There are some provisions in it. They can't lay off workers for 6 months if you accept the bailouts in the bill for some of the companies. But the problem is that the Trump administration can just waive the rule when pretty much whenever they want, which means they will waive the rule whenever they want. And so I think in the upcoming package, they're going to be putting in provisions so that they can't waive those rules. But there's so much that has to be done. They're also fighting with Chairwoman Maxine Waters. We are fighting to try to get a $2,000 recurring payment to every American, every US citizen, and every person with a social security number, which also includes some immigrants. And so we're trying to get $2,000 recurring plus $1,000 per child, because although they passed the $1,200, it's one time and that's not enough for our families. It's not enough to live on. So those are the things that they're trying to work on, but we need to fight for so much more. For the places that are on lockdown, we need rent and mortgage moratoriums. We need suspensions of rent and mortgages because we now have almost 20 million people that have filed for unemployment, almost 20 million people suddenly wow. without a job. And we're somehow trying to tell these people that they still need to pay their rent. It's ridiculous. It's wrong. And if we don't fix it, we are looking at mass displacement in the United States, where there's far more people, far more empty homes than there are people who become homeless. And we have to make sure that we're protecting working families in all of this.
Pues nada, no, ya no queda tiempo. Yo creo que tu español es muy bueno también.
Oh, gracias.
Para las respuestas, y la próxima la hacemos en español para toda la gente que está en Latinoamérica. Igual en Latinoamérica está bueno aprender otros idiomas, y para no lucir como países que solamente aprenden un idioma, sino ser países que aprendemos diferentes idiomas. Estamos abiertos a hablar tanto inglés como español y hasta chino. Creo que lo que está pasando, yo no creo en ningún sistema. A mí se me hace muy difícil, como que pienso que hay que inventarse cosas nuevas. Soy como que creo que estamos viviendo momentos distintos a hace mucho tiempo atrás, y que debemos empezar a crear ideas nuevas que vayan a tono con lo que está sucediendo hoy en día. Y con eso pienso que lo que está sucediendo en el Nueva York es es claro, un ejemplo vivo de hacia dónde puede ir el capitalismo al ver que la gente que está muriendo en Nueva York son los que no tienen. Y los
Exactamente.
Que, y los que tienen están bien y tienen la oportunidad de salvarse, los que no tienen están muriendo. Y tanto son latinoamericanos que están de inmigrantes allá, como los afroamericanos que están allá, y las minorías, todas las minorías son las que están sufriendo esta pandemia, pero exageradamente, y es triste. Y cuando se ve, cuando tú miras Nueva York, que es la ciudad, una de las ciudades más importantes del mundo, y ves lo que está pasando, se ve claro, para mí es claro, que no funciona el sistema y que hay que cambiarlo. Y no solo el capitalismo, yo no creo en ningún otro sistema, pienso que hay que crear cosas nuevas.
Sí.
Una idea.
Bueno, es una, como, es una locura que aquí siempre estamos diciendo en este país que somos, you know, el país más rico, rica, estamos, somos la país más rico, que somos el país más avanzada en el mundo, que tenemos la tecnología y no podemos garantizar el seguro médico a personas aquí en los Estados Unidos, que no damos, que una persona que trabaja en una tienda o trabaja en un trabajo regular no puede depender a ir a la hospital y tener tratamiento si no, you know, si no kind of bankrupt.
Y si no se va en bancarrota. Se
sí,
tiene que ir en
bancarrota. Y yo represento a una de las comunidades más impactados en los Estados Unidos. Yo, es la 14 Distrito Congresional de Nueva York, de los top 10, de los 10 comunidades más impactados, 5 son en mi distrito congresional, solamente en mi parte de Nueva York. Y el número 1 también es en mi distrito. Eso es en Queens, Corona, Jackson Heights, Elmhurst. Y son comunidades latinos, son comunidades indocumentados, somos inmigrantes, somos afroamericanos. Y también en todo eso, en nuestras comunidades, lo que yo estoy oyendo es que los pacientes que va ahí en la hospital, una de sus últimas palabras de antes que tener como
entubarlo, antes de entubarlo.
Antes de entubarlo, ellos están preguntando cuánto este va a costar mi familia.
Sí, eso, yo vi
sus
esa noticia.
Últimas palabras. Eso no pasa en un país compasionante, eso no pasa en un país moderna, en un país en un país rica, eso pasa en un país brutal. Y este es un sistema medicamento brutal, brutal por familias trabajadoras y brutal por mucho más familia. Y tenemos que cambiar este sistema porque tenemos que garantizar medicamento, tenemos que garantizarlo.
Sí, medicina y salud para todos. Y esa noticia, para los que no saben, salió hace poco, creo que fue en el New York Times, no estoy seguro, de un enfermero que escuchó a las últimas palabras de un paciente con coronavirus antes de morir, que lo iban a entubar. Sus últimas palabras fueron: ¿cuánto me va a costar esto? Esa es la representación de un sistema que no funciona. Cuando tus últimas palabras de vida son: ¿cuánto va a costar esto? Yo espero que la gente, luego de toda esta situación, esta pandemia, cambie para bien y entienda que nosotros como seres humanos tenemos que movilizarnos para que cambien las cosas. No podemos dejar tampoco de movilizarnos, que esto es algo que va a ser difícil luego de toda esta pandemia, porque tenemos que estar separados, nos están ordenando a que nos quedemos en nuestras casas. Y si te fijas, es casi como, no sé, como hay que quedarse en sus casas y todo el mundo tiene que obedecer y hay que quedarse, pero luego de que todo esto pase, hay que atreverse entonces a salir y manifestarse cuando es necesario para que esto no ocurra, para que una persona que esté muriendo en un hospital, sus últimas palabras no tengan que ser: ¿cuánto me va a costar esto? Nada, de nuevo, muchas gracias, Alexandria, gracias a todo el mundo que estuvo acá pendiente, y gracias por hacerlo también en español cada vez más.
Claro.
Es la práctica. I'm practicing in English too.
Yeah, know? That's right.
Yeah, so thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Bye.